This Sunday, we are going on to part two of a series on spiritual peace by looking at the biblical principles that are being offered in our course on Financial Peace University and discovering how they're not really about finance at all, but about spiritual life in general. Last week, we considered the concept of an emergency fund, spiritually speaking. That is, by maintaining a baseline of spiritual practice and attentiveness to regular worship and regular prayer, to provide ourselves with the spiritual resources to handle most of life's smaller, unexpected crises. When we're on the right track spiritually, life's little speed bumps and potholes are just that. They're minor inconveniences, and we get over them quickly. But when we are off track, though, even the smallest situations can turn us into a spin or a crash. If you find yourself melting down over small, insignificant things, chances are your spiritual emergency fund has dried up. Like the colorful characters in the Snickers bar commercial, you might need a Snickers bar of the soul. That is, a little bit of prayer, a little bit of quiet time to get our heart and our head straight again, and then sometimes, maybe even an actual Snickers bar would help. But try first. Today, we'll consider what is the most important concept or the most important method that's presented in Financial Peace University, the discipline of the monthly budget. Now, how many of you, when I use the word budget, began to cringe? How many of you hate that word and that concept? I don't want you to treat it like a dirty word here, okay? Budget just means a plan, just having a plan. And only by taking conscious control of our financial life can we begin to feel peace, because our financial life is no longer in control of us. We will happen to our money instead of money problems happening to us. And the same is true of spiritual life. That's why these principles are so good. If we are intentional and purposeful about how we spend our time and our energy and how we direct our soul, we become cooperators with God's grace, and it becomes actualized. That which was just potential becomes active in us. If we do not approach our spiritual lives with any sense of direction or purpose, then God's grace does not get actualized. It remains dormant within us. It does not come in automatically and direct us on autopilot. I think that even the teachers of Calvinism, for all of its flaws, would not expect anyone to expect such autopilot grace. They have irresistible grace, but not autopilot grace. We still have a job to do. We still have to be intentional about how we approach our spiritual life. God doesn't do all that work for us without us cooperating. St. Paul, in encouraging the wealthy church of Corinth to fulfill its pledges to help the churches in need, which we read today in our epistle, applies this very principle of planning. He says, "But this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So let each one gives as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, not out of reaction. For God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you always having sufficiency in all things may have an abundance for every good work." So God has provided us with spiritual gifts, the seeds, so to speak, that will be able to be multiplied. But they only get multiplied if we do what? If we sow the seed, if we put it to work. And if we put those seeds bountifully to work, if we put our spiritual gifts into action bountifully, purposefully, cheerfully, and not out of begrudging necessity, we will find that those spiritual gifts will multiply and affect not only ourselves but others. So we need to ask ourselves how it is that we are spending our time and energy. The The first thing you have to do before you can really do a budget financially is know what your cash flow picture is. You can make a plan, but if it's no connection to reality, it's not going to help. The same thing is true spiritually. We have to look and say, where am I spending my spiritual energy? Where am I focusing my time, my attentiveness, the cares of my heart? And am I generating peace and love and hope in the world? Or am I just contributing to its degradation and darkening? Start with our conversations. Are the conversations that we have edifying to those with whom we are speaking? Are we blessing or cursing when we speak? What about the time that we spend alone? Is it wasted on trivial and shallow entertainments, or even worse things? Are we neglectful of prayer because of that? What about our professional lives? Are we just grinding out our paychecks month to month, week to week? Or are we really making the world a better place and putting our talents to something that will give glory to God, starting at our workplace or at our schools? At the end of the day, can we give thanks to God like St. Paul because we have witnessed the increase of the fruits of righteousness? Or do we come before God in regret and shame for another day with nothing to show for it, if we even dare to approach Him at all? So this is where the concept of budgeting, believe it or not, can be of immense help to us. A budget, which again can be a dirty word in these parts, really means nothing more than having a plan. St. Paul was a man with a plan. He talks very often about how he planned to do this, how he was determined to do that, how he was ready for these things. He's always encouraging the faithful by reminding them of his purpose, of his intention, of that he is not just doing this chaotically, but with reason. And yet he also does so with the caveat that it is always God who is the one who provides both the strength to carry out the plan and the grace to see it accomplished. And this is from that tradition of wisdom that we find in the Proverbs that I mentioned last week. Proverbs 16:9, a man's heart plans his way, but the Lord directs his step. Proverbs 19:21, there are many plans in a man's heart. Nevertheless, the Lord's counsel, that will stand. And not only do we need the help of God, but we need the help of good counsel, good advice, so that our plans can be wise. Proverbs 15:22, without counsel, plans go awry, but in the multitude of counselors, they are established. So the idea of planning for us as Christians is checked by the need for humility and the need for accountability, being checked by others. That way we are differentiating our approach from the plans of the wicked, which we hear also a great deal about in the Proverbs and in the Psalms. We actually just sang that, right? The schemes, on that day their schemes perish, right? Proverbs 21:5, the plans of the diligent lead surely to plenty, but those of everyone who is hasty surely to poverty. Those who are trying to rush through things or be a little bit reckless in things leads to poverty. Proverbs 22:3, a prudent man foresees evil and hides himself, but the simple pass on and are punished. The prudent man, the careful and cautious man, recognizes danger ahead and prepares for it. All of these things are good wisdom financially, but they're even more good wisdom spiritually. And that's why, again, we read the book of Proverbs in great length when we're trying to do the most intensive focus on spiritual life over the course of the year. In fact, the idea of planning is at the heart of God's teaching about discipleship. When Jesus explains what is required to be his disciple, he appeals to two images of master planning. In Luke 14:27, starting, we begin to read, whoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple? For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not sit down first and count the cost, neither he has enough to finish it, lest after he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. Or what king, going to make war against another king, does not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? Or else, while the other is still a great way off, he sends a delegation and sues for peace. So likewise, whoever of you does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. We have to know the reality of our situation, and we have to plan accordingly. And that last verse is very kind of, it can be very intimidating. Whoever of you does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. Have you forsaken anything lately? Do you forsake things on a regular basis? Forsaking is not a bad word either, though it can sound like the word budgeting. Whenever you budget, you are making purposeful decisions about what you will choose and what you will forsake. Meaning, you will not do those things. You will not spend that money that way. You will not apply your energy in that direction. You will not go that way. And the gospel is telling us that we need to make sure that when we look at everything in our life, we are making sure that everything that we do is directed towards the kingdom of God. Because everything else directs us away from the kingdom of God. So we forsake those things that lead us away. And we direct everything we have. Even what we think is essential to us, those things are put to the service of the kingdom, and we forsake their selfish use. That includes our own family life, wife, mother, husband, father, brother, sister. All of these are forsaken. That doesn't mean that you'll never talk to your wife or your husband, Ted, or that you'll never take care of your mother or father or your children. What it means is that you will understand that they do not become the end-all be-all that you're working for. You work for the kingdom and bring them along with you. That's forsaken. So how can we utilize the concept of planning in our spiritual life on a very practical level? First, we must approach our spiritual life with the same type of purpose and intention that a master builder or a great military strategist approaches their tasks. We need to be clear about what gifts we lack and what gifts we possess and how to maintain them. If we are lacking in some virtue, we should seek the means of acquiring it. And if elsewhere we possess another virtue, let us give thanks to God and make good use of it, lest we lose it because of our pride or neglect. But secondly, we need to be precise and realistic about how our everyday time and energy is spent. In FPU, he talks about a zero-based budget, a balanced budget where every dollar is accounted for, all income and all expenses line up. Spiritually, we should talk about the same kind of thing. We can talk about a balanced or zero-based schedule, if you will. By looking at our calendars, we can make sure that we are putting in the right amount of time for all of these things, that we're not forsaking anything that matters, and that we're choosing to forsake the things that can be forsaken, should be. We need to apply the right amount of time to our spiritual well-being, to our mental health, physical health, and our service for God's kingdom. If we neglect this, we will not find that at the end of the month, a few days or a week have been tacked on to make up for all the time we have lost. We don't expect to find a magical sum of money appear in our bank account at the end of a pay period to make up for our shortfalls, do we? Unless they're Congress. We have to do the same thing with our time. Here are a few things that we should make sure that we plan for, that we just don't hope will happen, or hope that somehow appear at some point in our daily life. These are things that we have to intentionally prepare for. The first, what you're doing here today, obviously, as I said last week, worship. That baseline of grace can easily be dissipated and lost Regular attendance at worship services with others is a great way, of course, to recharge and replenish, to protect. But if Sunday is the only day you come to church, you might consider making room in your schedule for other services, either here or at another Orthodox church that's convenient for you, or just simply listening to services at home. We have so many beautiful things to listen to now, services, prayers, online, on CDs, etc. Just bring the presence of prayer and worship into your life, and don't let it be neglected. Two, on the same note, confession and communion. Not only do these things energize our walk with God, but they help us stay accountable. They help us stay on point. You know, when you know every week that you have to be accountable for your actions, because on Sunday you have the opportunity to come and receive the body and blood of Christ, and you know you must do so in at least a modicum state of worthiness, though we are never truly worthy, we know there are some things that will prevent us from approaching. And confession is one of those things, right? We have to know we're having a recent confession. These things help us live purposefully and give meaning to our daily activities so that they're not just squandered. The third item is fellowship, or friendship, more precisely. Friendships that are maintained and nurtured in Christ become the long-term emergency fund for life's bigger challenges. We read Friday in our book study a wonderful set of passages by St. Maximus on friends in Christ, friendship in Christ. I'll bring those to you later in this series. But knowing that you have people who can help you in times of need, and that you in return are helped, are needed by them, will help to keep you connected and striving for the kingdom of God. Putting time to stay in touch with them, or even just to pray for them, your friends in Christ, is a great use of your time and will not happen unless you choose to do so. Fourth is service. You know, life, as wonderful as it can be, gets pretty dull when we live just for ourselves. There's nothing more enriching when we start to see how our life actually impacts other lives, and we see the influence we can have on other people and make their life better. Even if we don't see them directly, we know that we can participate in things that help the world. For example, charity. And while writing a check is, of course, to be commended, spending some time in actual service is even more enriching spiritually for us. For what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? The Lord asks us in Mark 8:36. Service requires time and energy, and we have to plan for that, very realistically. Lastly, I want to speak of just general enrichment. Under that heading, you could put Bible study, spiritual reading, religious education, ancient faith radio, edifying podcasts, you know, all these good things, quiet time. All of these things, we may find that at the end of the month, we look back and say, I wish I had done more. I feel like I did nothing. I feel like I haven't cracked open my Bible in months or more. We don't just wish if we want to get this done. We have to be proactive. Schedule time for them and do not apologize to anyone, including yourself, for doing so. A wise planner named Father Deacon Peter once told me that when he was in his working career, he would put into his schedule on a weekly basis MWM, and told his secretary that he was not to be disturbed for that 45 minutes to an hour. Finally, years later, he was asked, what is this MWM that you do all the time? And he said simply, meeting with myself. Made sure he had that quiet time to recenter, to focus, to remember what's important. All of these aspects of a good Christian life require us to think ahead and to plan, to budget. We don't need to detail every single minute of our day. We don't need to craft a schedule at 10, I am here at 10:15. I'm going to, you know, et cetera. You can if you really like that. But I would actually encourage you, when we talked about this, the proverb saying wise counsel helps establish your plan, do this with somebody else. If you're married, work with your spouse. If your spouse, you know, understands what you're trying to accomplish, or work with a spiritual friend in Christ, or work with your spiritual father, or your godfather or godmother. Work with somebody who will understand what you're trying to accomplish and help you coordinate yourself. You can do this in so many different ways. Set for yourself goals. Block out time for those things that you know you need in your spiritual life. Don't just pray for them to come later. We'll be able to see happening in our life exactly what St. Paul saw in his life and in the lives of those who did the same, fulfilling this prayer, which we read today in our epistle reading and with which I'll close. May he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food supply and multiply the seed you have sown and increase the fruits of your righteousness, while you are enriched in everything for all generosity, which causes thanksgiving through us to God. Amen. Christ is among us.